This is the back door.
If you will please take your Bibles and open up to Matthew chapter 27. Matthew chapter 27, the message this morning will be about the resurrection. Matthew chapter 27. We're going to look at proofs of the resurrection. Proofs of the resurrection. In the other church, individuals that had come to Christ after the resurrection came, some of them, from a sect of the Jews, division, the Pharisees, and they denied the resurrection. The Pharisees didn't believe that there was really life after death. As a matter of fact, that is actually a common teaching among certain Jews today. As well, that is, you die and go into the ground and there is no eternal life, there's no life after death or no resurrection. And in dealing with that heresy in the church at Corinth, the Apostle Paul wrote to them in 1 Corinthians 5:17, he said, "And if Christ be not raised, your faith is vain, ye are yet in your sins." And that's as true today as it was then. If Jesus is not risen, my friend, it's all a sham. It's all a fake. And it's nothing more than religion and has no practical benefit beyond this life. But fortunately, Jesus is risen. So we're going to look at the evidences of that. We're first going to look at the resurrection of Jesus. And we will be in Matthew chapter 27 this morning. And we're going to begin in verse 62 at the end of the chapter. This is the preparation. The Bible says, "Now the next day that followed the day of the preparation, the chief priests and Pharisees came together unto Pilate, saying, Sir, we remember that deceiver said while he was yet alive, After 3 days I will rise again. Command therefore that the sepulchre be made sure until the third day, lest his disciples come by night and steal him away and say unto the people, He is risen from the dead, so the last error shall be worse than the first. Pilate said unto them, Ye have a watch, go your way, make it as sure as you can. So they went and made the sepulchre sure, sealing the stone and setting a watch. In the end of the Sabbath, as it began to dawn toward the first day of the week, came Mary Magdalene and the other Mary to see the sepulchre. And behold, there was a great earthquake, for the angel of the Lord descended from heaven and came and rolled back the stone from the door and sat upon it. His countenance was like lightning, and his raiment white as snow. And for fear of him, the keepers did shake and became as dead men. And the angel answered and said unto the women, Fear not ye, for I know that ye seek Jesus, which is crucified. He is not here, for he is risen, as he said. Come, see the place where the Lord lay, and go quickly and tell his disciples that he is risen from the dead, and behold, he goeth before you into Galilee. There shall ye see him. Lo, I have told you. And they departed quickly from the sepulchre with fear and great joy, and did run to bring his disciples word. And as they went to tell his disciples, behold, Jesus met them, saying, All hail. And they came and held him by the feet and worshipped him. Then said Jesus unto them, Be not afraid. Go tell my brethren that they go into Galilee, and there they shall see me. Now when they were going, behold, some of the watch came into the city and showed unto the chief priests all the things that were done. And when they were assembled with the elders and had taken counsel, they gave large money unto the soldiers, saying, Say ye, his disciples came by night and stole him away while he slept. And if this come to the governor's ears, we'll persuade him and secure you. So they took the money and did as they were taught. And this saying is commonly reported among the Jews until this day. We'll look this morning at evidences for the resurrection. Father, please help us now to understand your word. Help us to be strengthened in our faith. And God, help us to be thrilled by the resurrection of our Savior and the implications that we are ourselves risen because Jesus is risen. Help us now as we go to your word, both with attention, alertness, and God, I pray with just our hearts. Help us to adore you with our hearts as we see what you've done for us. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, the resurrection is everything to one who calls himself a Christian. Many individuals would be born into a household or a family which would be Christian. It's not this way in southern Florida. But when I lived in North Florida, which was a part of the Bible Belt in Pensacola, when I would knock on doors frequently, people would tell me they were Baptist. And in conversation, if I could get them to be honest about the last time they'd been in a Baptist church, it sometimes had been years and years, or for some people, maybe once or twice in their entire lifetime. And yet they consider themselves to be Baptist. Why do they consider themselves to be Baptist? Well, because that's what their parents considered themselves to be, and they figured that it was hereditary, or that it just happened that you're born that way. Truthfully, many people believe themselves to be Christian because they come from a family that believes itself to be Christian. And the fact of the matter is unless that's in some way challenged intellectually, unless the thinking behind that is challenged, that can go on for generation after generation after generation. For instance, it is in most cases not offensive to talk about Jesus to American people who are actually born and raised in America, for the most part. I recognize that we do live in an area where there is a very anti-God sentiment, more so than other parts of the country. But for most people born in America, people just assume that they're Christian and that Christ rose from the dead and so forth. Matter of fact, this is the day of the year, oftentimes, that people who don't regularly worship actually go to church. And so there are people, and that's becoming less and less of a tradition, I'm learning. The fact is, this morning, Anthony and I went over to get my bagel and his donut at the Safeway next door, and the place is packed out. The parking lot was full early this morning. And if you go inside, people are buying two things. They're buying, like, hams and turkeys, like meat, and they're buying flowers. And they're wearing their pajamas. Which is indicative of only a few things. Primarily, I think that they're probably not on their way to church. Although I know that there are pajama churches today. I do acknowledge that things like that do exist. But most of them are not going to church today. They're not going to worship Jesus today. Most of them are celebrating Easter today entirely without Jesus or the resurrection. Now, again, I'm just stating the facts. That's actually true. In this church today, there are regular people who are missing because they're celebrating Easter. It surprises me. It's tough on me as a pastor. But it's actually, I shouldn't say that. I'm over it being tough on me as a pastor. I am to the place where I realize that it's something that we really have got to get a hold of lost people and really get a replacement generation, if you will, of people that understand the resurrection. Because the fact of the matter is that Christians really celebrate the resurrection Easter Sunday without Jesus. It's surprising to me, but it's a fact. It's not something I'm making up. And there are people who have never celebrated Easter in church. I don't know whether it's official or not. I'm not ranting. I'm just trying to lay some foundation here this morning. I don't know whether there is officially something in our city today, but I assume that in our city there's an Easter egg hunt going on probably right now. Where kids are hunting Easter eggs. And I know, some churches have really great Easter egg hunts, and different people come down all over the place on that. I just can't bring myself to do it. I just can't. I'm not against candy. I'm not against kids having a good time. Matter of fact, I think we should probably just have kids come in and just give them a bucket and just fill it up with all kinds of candy and send them home to their parents. I'm for candy. There's nothing wrong. I mean, just rot their little teeth right out, especially if they're their baby teeth, you know. So, you know, I'm all for that. So understand, that isn't my point, but I just can't bring myself to have an Easter egg hunt because that's what the pagans are doing today. And we're celebrating the resurrection. Okay, so here's the deal. Let's celebrate it. Let's make a lot out of the resurrection. Let's make a lot out of Jesus. And let's spread the word. Let's let people know. I understand. Listen, I have talked about this with people that skip church on Easter Sunday for their family dinner. And they said, oh, I know, Pastor. I know. I hate when people say, I know, but it doesn't mean anything, you know. It's like I'm going to do it anyway, but I know. But my family, they just wouldn't understand if I went to church and I didn't go to the family. I think that you could just do both in their place, or you could just influence your family to celebrate the resurrection. But, you know, but the kids just don't understand, Pastor. I mean, they just, you know, they got to have Easter eggs on Easter Sunday or we're just going to be taking something from them. I know that people think like that. I know. I recognize that that vein of thought is prevalent and mainstream. But it misses the point. And here's the deal. I actually have my own budget. This is pretty neat. I remember being a kid and wanting to be an adult and get to do whatever I wanted to do. You know, kids, that's what adults do, right? Mm-hmm. Whatever they want to do, that's what kids think, right? And here's the deal. I could actually go to the store and buy, like, tons of candy and indulge myself in getting sick on it or give it to people for any reason I want to. And I will and I do. So, there. For the folks that say, oh, we're missing out. No, I think I'm going to go buy another big bag of Hershey's Kisses and give it to the kids. You know, and some M&Ms. How about those peanut butter Reese's? You don't tell M&Ms? The peanut butter Reese's M&Ms? Yeah. They don't do anything for Taj. But Charlie likes them, don't you, Charlie? Yeah, okay. So, anyway, we're done talking about candy now. Folks, we need to be real, though, as a church, and we need to understand what is mainstream with people's thinking. And what is mainstream is that redemption's completion is trivial, and celebrations that are auxiliary are primary, right? Okay, so I'm not picking up. I don't care if you think it's okay to have an Easter egg hunt. I don't even care about that. I wish our city didn't have one, but and compete with church at taxpayers' expense. But that's that. Now, I want to look at proofs or evidences of the resurrection. You know, as I studied and looked at this, the first thing I want to see this morning, or I want us to emphasize, is that the first proof that you find in Matthew 27 of the resurrection is the unbeliever's take on it. In other words, one of the things, when I look at the scriptural biblical account of the resurrection, one of the things that proves to me that Jesus indeed was risen from the dead was the response of people who did not believe on Him. Now, I did not say they did not believe that He existed, and I did not say that they did not believe that He was resurrected. But I'm talking about people who did not receive Jesus as unbelievers. You understand that's what differentiates between a believer and an unbeliever. A believer looks to Jesus, an unbeliever refuses Jesus. Nothing to do with facts. Secular historians like Josephus, for instance, who did not believe in Jesus, reported Jesus. And even reported the miraculous aspects of Jesus. I'm always amazed reading historians like Josephus who give account of the miracles that Christ did, and their commentary on the miracles is that it was evident that He must have been supernatural or come from God. Even though they themselves did not trust Him or look to Him as their Savior, unbelievers believed in the resurrection. And that, for me, is an uncommonly good witness to the truth of the resurrection. It's one thing when somebody who believes something tells you something or acknowledges something. It's another thing when somebody who is against something acknowledges it, isn't it? It's one thing when somebody who is against Jesus acknowledges the resurrection. And so that is in our context this morning. Let's look at the unbelievers, particularly described in verse 11. Actually, verse 62 is the first part I want to look at, I'm sorry, of chapter 27. The Bible says in verse 62, the chief priests and Pharisees came together unto Pilate, saying, Sir, we remember that deceiver said, while he was yet alive, after 3 days I'll rise again. Command therefore that the sepulchre be made until the third day, lest his disciples come by night and steal him away, and say unto the people, he's risen from the dead, so the last error shall be worse than the first. Even after they had managed to be responsible for the crucifixion of Jesus, the chief priests were concerned about him. While Jesus lay in the tomb, he was a threat to the unbelieving chief priests and Pharisees who did not receive him as their Savior. Is that amazing? Is that amazing? I mean, the death of a person usually is the end of their threat. And yet Jesus' body is laying in the tomb, and the chief priests and Pharisees are concerned that the end of, they called it error, his error, is going to be worse than the first or the beginning. In other words, if he were to perform what he said he would do, and that is that he had said that he would raise his body again within 3 days, if he were to do that, that would be worse than what he did before. And that's an amazing threat. Okay, we have a saying, don't we, when you really believe something? Put your money where your mouth is. How much did the Pharisees how much did they believe in the resurrection before it happened? Well, enough to spend a lot of money on it. Enough to spend a lot of money. First of all, and by the way, this is auxiliary, it's not the point of the message this morning, but it's interesting that they clearly understood that Jesus had said that he would be raised again from the dead. They understood. It's amazing that the disciples didn't quite get that, but the Pharisees and the chief priests did. They knew that Jesus said he would be raised again from the dead, and they believed it enough to pay to try to prevent it. And so Pilate answered him. He said, okay, you have a watch. You can have a watch. And he gave them a watch. Now, I've had people tell me from their research that they believe that there were as many as 50 individuals in this watch. But looking at it, a watch consisted of 4 individuals who were on a 4-hour rotation. And that's pretty fair. As a matter of fact, did you ever hear about, when people read you Roman history and tell you about what would happen to the watch if they fell asleep and so forth? I mean, we see the illustration of it in the text where the Pharisees said, you say that you fell asleep, and if the governor hears about it, we'll secure you. We'll make sure that you're not put to death. I'm not sure I would trust them in that matter, but that's what they... You say you fell asleep, and then we'll secure you. And they gave them a large sum of money to be quiet about the resurrection. I've heard that they would follow, that if you fell asleep on your watch, that was actually a death penalty. But here's the deal. A watch was only 4 hours. It was only 4 hours. And if it were that serious, I could stay awake for 4 hours, couldn't you? I think of it in terms of that 4 a.m. Anybody here like to drive at 4 a.m. in the morning? I hate driving at 4 a.m. Like, there's something about that 3 and 4 o'clock time. I think gravity is stronger at 3 and 4 a.m. You know what I'm talking about, right? Pulls your eyelids shut, makes your head nod. Like, actually is pulling down on you at 3 and 4 a.m. So there's something a little tough about that. But if it were a matter of life or death, I could keep my watch for 4 hours, no matter what time of the day it was. I could just prepare myself for it. So the watch is 4 hours on, and then the next watch would come and relieve them. And a watch did consist of at least 4 people. So here's the deal. If the Roman guards, if one of them were to fall asleep, it's highly unlikely that four of them would fall asleep, isn't it? It's just not very likely. On a four-hour shift, four people all nodding off. You know, what's the purpose of having more than one person on a watch? Well, I think two people are to watch. You know, you two watch me, make sure I don't fall asleep, and I'll watch and make sure nothing bad happens from somewhere else. You know, so this is a pretty well thought out. The Romans were fairly intelligent and had a pretty good set to their watch. Okay, so the first evidence of the resurrection was that the unbelievers, and by unbeliever, we do define that as one who has not put their faith in, not looked to the Savior as their Savior, not individuals that didn't believe that Jesus was God. These chiefs, priests, and Pharisees knew that Jesus was God. No doubt about that at all. By the miracles that He did, they knew who He was. They rejected Him as their Savior. Therefore, they were unbelievers, and yet they believed in the resurrection before it happened. Not only so, but they believed in the resurrection after it happened, because the watch, which was set over it, came to them. Looking down in verse 11, the Bible says, "Now when they were going, behold, some of the watch came into the city and showed unto the chief priests all the things that were done. And when they were assembled with the elders and had taken counsel, they gave large money unto the soldiers." They believed in the resurrection so much that they paid off the soldiers. How much money did they give the soldiers? A lot. That's what the Bible says. Now think about this. In chapter 27, in verse 3, we have the account of Judas and the money that was given to him, and how that after he realized what he'd been done, and after he realized how he'd been used, he brought the money back to the chief priests and said, "I don't want blood money." And they said, "We don't care about that." And he threw it down and walked out and hanged himself. But Judas had been given 30 pieces of silver. Someday, if the Lord allows me to go to Israel, I want to go to Hinnom, which is the word that, the word Gehenna actually became a euphemism for hell, because it was a place where the Jews worshiped Molech and offered their babies as burning sacrifices to Molech. And it literally was a burning hell, a physical place, Gehenna. And there at Hinnom today is the place where they took the money that Judas threw down on the ground and bought the potter's field where the poor were laid to rest, or where today is, we have potter's fields in a lot of places. There's an island in New York that's a potter's field, for instance. But a potter's field is basically a cemetery where people that can't afford to be buried get buried. I want to visit there because of the historic significance of that place, both for pagan Israel, but also being a place that was purchased because of the betrayal of Judas, of Jesus' body. Why is that significant? Well, because, believe it or not, historically there are people that deny today the existence of Jesus. In other words, they just say, "Well, Jesus never existed. He was a made-up figment or figure of imagination." Well, it's interesting that there's a couple thousand-year-old burial ground that was purchased and is still a place that, it's been taken over as a monastery or something like that, but it's a place historically that was purchased with the money that the chief priests paid Judas to betray Jesus. So here we see that the first witness of the resurrection is the people who refused to trust Jesus or to believe in Jesus as their Savior, but yet they believed in the resurrection. Isn't that amazing? I'll be honest with you, that's kind of enough, isn't it? Yeah. How many evidences do we need of the resurrection? How many things do I need to know are absolutely true in order for myself to believe in Jesus? Just probably one, right? Well, there's one. Okay, let's look at another one. The second evidence of the resurrection is the evidence of the disciples. Now, this, I think we all would agree, would be biased evidence. Wouldn't you say so? In other words, if you're going to look for bias for or pro-resurrection, you and I would be more prone to say that the chief priests and Pharisees who paid to have the resurrection covered up were less biased for, they certainly were biased against it. But the testimony of what they said and what they did, you would have to say the fact that they believed in the resurrection, that that would be an unbiased witness. The disciples certainly were biased, weren't they? Now, I want to point out something about that very quickly. The disciples seemed to understand the, in 3 days I will raise this temple up again, less than the chief priests and the Pharisees did. Isn't it true? In other words, when Jesus is talking about the death that he's going to die, the disciples are all rebuking him all over the place. Peter is the one who verbalized it. But every one of them is saying, you know, no, Lord. And then when they're talking about him going away, I mean, it just seems like it just went right over their head. But when Jesus was resurrected, the events are told this way and from this perspective. Two Marys came to the tomb, to the garden tomb. And when they came, there was an earthquake. That would get your attention. And the stone was rolled away. Now, what we know about it, and we believe the garden tomb is the physical location, another place I'd like to visit in Israel. We believe the garden tomb is the place. And so the way the stone would work would be that it would be a very heavy stone that would have been on a grade sloped downward in a channel. So it would be a cut stone in a channel sloping downward. And it's more difficult to roll a stone uphill than downhill. We know that, right? I try to do things downhill most of the time. If I'm going to cut a heavy branch of a tree, I want to make sure that while it's coming down, it goes where I want it to go. That way I don't have to move it later. So I'll rope it down and let it down into the back of a truck or whatever I have to do. It's very difficult to pick something up, go up. And the same is true with rolling the stone downhill. So this is really an amazing thing that the angel rolls the stone away. And then the Bible says that he was sitting on the stone. And again, he is not here, for he has risen. As he said, come see the place where the Lord lay. Come see. He's risen, as he said. I wish, for my own personal entertainment, there would be individual descriptions of the soldiers in this scene. I think, this is only speculation, but I think in this scene, the earthquake has really taken care of the fight in the watch, probably. Isn't it so? I think the earthquake probably got the at least four guys that were watching the grave, probably got them surviving instead of defending or protecting or guarding the grave. But following that, if that didn't get them into the non-guarding mode, I think that the angel sitting on the stone definitely did that. You ever meet somebody that's just incredibly strong? Like really, really strong? Yes, you have. You've met me. I love saying that just because of the looks at some of your faces. Some of you are like, I just love that look on your face. Okay, so you meet somebody that's really strong, and you watch some of the things they do, and it really amazes you. Well, can you imagine this angel going, shoving the stone, rolling the stone away, and then sitting on it? If I were a guard, I'd be done guarding. I would be an onlooker. But here's what I see in my mind. Probably did not happen this way, but in my mind, I see the guards go from guarding to observing to being keenly interested. And when the angel said, come see the place where the Lord lay, them saying, yeah, he's not there. In other words, I think that they, the guards, were witnesses of the resurrection. I suspect personally, and I think that we would probably agree about this, that the guards ultimately became believers in Jesus. You could not have seen an event like the resurrection and have honestly reported it as they did. See, they were paid a large sum of money not to tell what happened or to lie and say that they fell asleep on their watch and the disciples overpowered them and took the body of the Savior. They were paid to say that, but the reality of it is that they didn't say that. They told everybody what actually happened. And And I believe the reason, one of the motivations was that they became believers in the resurrection, in the resurrected Jesus. Not just, I believe the resurrection happened. And so, then the witness of the disciples. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, if you'd like to turn there, it would be a help because we'll be there for our next point. But the, what we're looking at right now is that believers saw the were eyewitnesses or witnesses of the resurrection. And so that's our second evidence of the resurrection. Paul said in verse 1 of 1 Corinthians 15, "Moreover, brethren, I declare unto you the gospel which I preached unto you, which ye have also received, and wherein ye stand, by which also ye are saved, if ye keep in memory what I preached unto you, unless ye believed in vain." What's the gospel? Verse 3. "For I delivered unto you, first of all, that which I also received, how that Christ died for our sins, according to the Scriptures, and that He was seen of Cephas, then of the 12." Okay, so we see that after the resurrection, Cephas, who is Peter, saw Jesus. So Peter is an eyewitness of the resurrection. Secondly, the 12, the rest of the disciples, saw the Lord Jesus resurrected. And I think you understand that one of those 12 probably would have been Matthias. That's included here. That's just an interesting note. After that, in verse 6, the Bible says, "After that, he was seen of above 500 brethren at once." And then the Scripture says, in its contemporary day, "of whom the great part remain unto this present, but some are fallen asleep." So the Scripture says in 1 Corinthians 15 that Peter saw Jesus resurrected. Paul's going to say that he himself saw Jesus resurrected. But he also mentions that 500 brethren simultaneously, at the same time, 500 believers saw the resurrected Jesus. Now my question for you is this. How many is enough? In other words, Peter said, "I saw Jesus risen from the dead." And with his life, Peter evidenced that he believed Christ was risen. Isn't it so? I mean, it was not the prosperity gospel for the founding apostles of the church at Jerusalem. You know that, right? It was they almost all of them were put to death except for John. Every one of them pretty much died because of their belief in Jesus. They were martyred because of their faith in the resurrection, because of what they'd seen. And so Peter's witness is good enough for me, actually. When Peter says in 2 Peter that we were eyewitnesses, and he said we were with him on the mount when he was transfigured, in other words, he became glorified as God, he said, "We saw that." He said, "I'm an eyewitness of the resurrection." And then the Scripture, just Paul says, 500 brethren, most of them are still alive. So we could compile a list. And you could go and ask them, "Did you see the resurrected Jesus?" And the answer would be, "I did. I saw the resurrected Jesus, and I was satisfied that Jesus was risen from the dead." That's good, isn't it? That's a helpful witness. It's a good testimony. Albeit, for me, in court, the evidence I would consider the most strongly would be the chief priest. Because they didn't believe in him, and yet their actions acknowledged that Jesus was risen, and they believed he would rise from the dead. So that's a strong witness. But the believers are a witness. And the third witness we see is also in the same text of the Scripture, 1 Corinthians 15. The Bible says in verse 3, "For I delivered unto you, first of all, that which I also received, how that Christ died for our sins, according to the Scriptures." And here we find a better evidence for the resurrection than the chief priests and unbelievers, and a better evidence for the resurrection, according to Paul and according to Peter, and that is the witness of the Word of God. This is of significant note. It's a message or a sermon in and of itself. But were you to study 2 Peter chapter 1, where Peter says, we have a more sure word of prophecy in reference to more sure word or better witness evidence of Christ's resurrection, Peter is using God's Word. In other words, Peter said, I saw with my very eyes the glorified Jesus. I saw with my eyes the resurrected Jesus. And I am telling you that Jesus is risen, that Jesus is God. And I am telling you that He's the Savior of the world and He's the only means for eternal life. But Peter said, better than that, God's Word says so. And Paul is saying the exact same thing here by first mention. In other words, Paul doesn't first explain, I saw Jesus risen, he says in this text. But you know, last of all, he was seen by me also as of one born out of due time. He said, I saw the resurrected Jesus. He doesn't point to that. He doesn't say there are 500 people who can tell you they saw the resurrected Jesus. The first witness that Paul gives that Jesus is risen from the dead is the Word of God, according to the Scriptures. What Scriptures? Well, read Daniel 9 sometime and look at the prophecy of the coming of the Messiah and then the prophecy that He would be cut off and that it would only be for a time. It's a witness of the resurrection. Look at Isaiah chapter 53 sometime and look at the prophecy that He would be wounded for our transgressions, He would be bruised for our iniquity, with His stripes we would be healed. That is the death and the resurrection of Jesus Christ. And the Old Testament does prophesy of a resurrected Savior, and the New Testament prophesies, or the New Testament witnesses, that Jesus Christ is risen from the dead. Nothing will convince you of the resurrection, my friend, more than reading God's Word. I have witnessed individuals who are adamantly opposed to believing in the existence of God, and if they believed in God, believing that Jesus was God, and if they believed that Jesus was God, believing that He'd been raised from the dead. And I've seen individuals who've read God's Word, and the witness of God's Word shows them that the resurrection is true. The Bible is the most accurate historical book there is, by the way. Let me point that out to you. A lot of times we try to be careful not to cite the Bible because it's biased toward God. It's biased. But history that disagrees with the Bible has always been proven to be spurious. But the Bible has never been proven to be wrong historically. And so it's the most accurate history book. Some people look at it as simply nice literature or poetry or something along those lines. But the fact of the matter is that it is accurate historical evidence, and in this case, the testimony of the Word of God is historical evidence of the resurrection. It's too bad, isn't it, that some individuals who go under the name of Christian or followers of Christ give very little credence to the witness of the Scripture when it is the greatest evidence that we have of the resurrection. God's Word says so, and that's enough for me. Study sometime the credibility of the given or inspired, preserved Word of God, and you'll come to the conclusion that it is the strongest witness to the resurrection when compared with the witness of the unbelieving chief priests and rulers and Pharisees and the believing disciples. In comparison with those two groups, the Bible outweighs extraordinarily in a way that cannot be compared. It outweighs in weight of evidence as a proof of the resurrection, way more so. I know that's a poor way of phrasing it, but the Bible is a greater evidence of the resurrection. Well, then Paul lists, of course, himself as a witness. Okay, so let me just mention one that just occurs to me. We've seen unbelievers are a proof of the resurrection. Believers or disciples are a proof of the resurrection. The Word of God is an evidence of the resurrection. Here's another one. In Acts chapter 1, after Jesus was raised from the dead and He was teaching His disciples, they asked Him, He taught them for 40 days about the kingdom, and then they asked Him when He was going to set up His kingdom. And in verse 7, He said to them, "It's not for you to know the times or the seasons which the Father hath put in His own power, but ye shall receive power after that the Holy Ghost has come upon you, and ye shall be witnesses unto me, both in Jerusalem and all Judea and in Samaria and unto the uttermost part of the earth." The witness of the gospel, or the witness of the resurrection through the church, is an evidence of the resurrection. In other words, the existence of the church today is a proof of the resurrection. Something happened or we wouldn't be here. Does that make sense? It doesn't take a lot to say something happened or Fort Lauderdale Baptist Church would not be meeting this morning. This is a church. And this church came into existence as a result of the resurrection. It's a proof of the resurrection. In other words, what is it that our church proclaims, believes, and teaches? The death, the burial, and the resurrection of Jesus, right? In other words, we the church are fulfilling the Great Commission, what Jesus told His disciples to wait at Jerusalem to accomplish. And the church is still doing that today. Literally, as you read through Acts, you see the acts of the Holy Spirit in using the apostles to establish the church. And as you study and you read what happened in the church being established, you realize here we are. This is where we came into existence. The church did not exist functionally, I should say. The church did not functionally exist before the resurrection. It did not functionally exist before the power of Pentecost, before the power of the Holy Spirit came down. And then the church began to carry out, perform its work. And today we have a church that's a result of the resurrection. So, if this morning we had individuals who came to worship with us as unbelievers, individuals who had, to this point in time, never accepted that Jesus Christ was God and that Jesus died for our sins, was buried, and rose again, and they haven't personally received the gift of eternal life because of what Jesus did, if that were true, an evidence for you this morning is that you're here as acknowledging a body of believers that came into existence as the result of the resurrection. And I think that's a pretty good evidence, isn't it? Now, I will acknowledge with that point, and I don't want to spend any time just to acknowledge it. I will acknowledge that everybody that comes together doesn't come together exactly in the name of Jesus. In other words, much is done because the church has been hijacked by politicization, if you want to say it that way, that's the word. And so they're coming together for reasons other than to acknowledge the resurrection. But the existence of the church, the concept of the church, and where the church originated before it was hijacked by the Constantine Emperor of Rome, and made a political religion, what we know as Catholicism and its offshoots today. Before that happened, my friend, there was a church. And so there's a fake church, but that fake church is imitating parts of the true church. And the true church came into existence because of the resurrection. Isn't that marvelous? So the fact that you're worshiping this morning is an evidence of the resurrection. The final witness of the resurrection, I believe, the most personal, the most important one to us, is the experience that a believer has when he puts his trust in Jesus. Jesus promised his disciples in scriptures that we alluded to this morning that if they were, that after he were to go away, if he were, when he went away, the kids quoted the scripture this morning in John 16. When he said that, hey, I'm quoting later in John 16 where he says, it's expedient for you that I go away, for if I go not away, the Comforter will not come unto you. But when Jesus said, promised that His Spirit, the Holy Spirit of God, would come and live in and dwell in believers, my friend, you and I personally know what that is from our experience when we believed in the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus in a personal way. And that brings us to our conclusion this morning. See, the resurrection actually is as meaningful as a bunch of eggs hidden in a field if you haven't trusted Jesus as your Savior. Perhaps the resurrection is less meaningful than a field full of eggs if you haven't trusted Jesus as your Savior. It's true, isn't it? I mean, honestly, if the Holy Spirit of God didn't live in me, I'd get more excited about eggs that had Snickers bars hidden in them I get more excited about chocolate bunnies on sale at Safeway tomorrow. I'm not saying I'm not excited about those. Just looking at Taj wants makes me want to buy one. But the fact of the matter is that if I didn't have God's Holy Spirit living in me, and if I hadn't been risen with Christ, just about anything would be more exciting to me than the resurrection. But it's real. When Jesus died, my friend, I remind you that He died as one who had never sinned. And yet He died for sin. Whose sin? Mine. Died for my sin. And I needed a Savior. I needed someone to take my sin debt and go to the cross. I needed the cross of Jesus. When Jesus was buried, my sin was buried with Him. And the load of guilt that so burdened me was buried. And I was unburdened. And friend, when Jesus rose from the dead, He not only fulfilled the promise, but my friend, I then was risen with Him. And today am living dead to sin and alive unto God. Literally, this moment, we're about to go to God and talk to Him, because the wrath of God, which was against each of us who are in sin, has been satisfied. And not only satisfied, but friend, we have been made who were dead in sin. We've been made alive. And not only that, but the Comforter, God's Holy Spirit, is the seal of my salvation. When I was born again, God's Spirit came in me. And He lives in me today. And He lives in you today. And because of His being in us, today God's Spirit is with us and filling this room, this place. And He is the ultimate witness of the resurrection. And if one here this morning were to say, I don't know whether the resurrection actually happened, without the witness of the unbelieving chief priests and Pharisees, without the witness of the believing disciples in 500 who saw Him, without the witness of Paul, of Peter, without even the witness of God's Word, God's Holy Spirit can grab a hold of your heart and just crush it and say, I'm real. And Jesus is risen. And if those witnesses are not sufficient for you to look to Jesus, you're no different than the Pharisees who are eyewitnesses of His supernatural power. Because He's risen, and you can believe it. But if you do not, it is not because you cannot, it is because you will not. And you're an unbeliever by choice, not because there are no witnesses of the resurrection. If you have believed it, when you hear the witnesses of the resurrection, they simply testify to something that you know to be true. You say, Pastor, I enjoyed the message this morning, but it didn't convince me of anything because I already knew. And that's great too, isn't it? Because here this morning, what we're doing as believers is celebrating something we already knew. Jesus is alive. And it doesn't have to be Easter Sunday for me to know Jesus is alive, but it's pretty special that it's Easter Sunday. It's a great truth, isn't it? And it's great to hear the proofs of it. God, thank You for what we've heard this morning. And I ask that the thrill of it and the truth of it would convince us of the importance of teaching others the same. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. I want to do something a little different than the invitation this morning. If you have to leave, if you've got to be somewhere right now, that would be just fine. But before I dismiss our service this morning, I would like to just take the opportunity. I think it would be perfectly appropriate on a day like this to praise the Lord. And so if you would just like to maybe give a witness of your salvation or something that just has to do with Resurrection Sunday and just share it this morning, I think it would be an appropriate time to do that, wouldn't it? Would anyone like to share anything about the resurrection or their salvation this morning? Chuck.
I'd like to thank the Lord for His witness inside of me that He's given me love and affection for other people that I never really even knew before. And He's shown Himself real in my life in answering prayer. And I know that He has changed my life. Jesus is my Savior.
Amen. Yeah, that's the resurrection in you. Anyone else? You don't have to use a microphone, but it helps for some people. Privilege of being saved as a child. And it's just so wonderful that I didn't have to wait to know the resurrection. But I want to just tell you this as a personal testimony. I'm 38 years old. I got saved when I was 4 years old, so I've been saved for 34 years now. I thank God for that. But it means more to me today, the resurrection, Resurrection Sunday, than it ever has before. And I think it probably will increase in meaning to me the closer I get to being with Him forever. Anybody else want to share anything before we dismiss? Yes, Joel?
I was saved in June of 96 in Hawaii. I was 20 years old. And then, I guess the impact of it, obviously I'm here beyond that, and I'm going to heaven. But just the reality of the fact, we weren't very religious growing up, but we did grow up Catholic, so I had some exposure. And just the truth, the impact of the fact that Jesus is alive. As a result, I have direct access to God. I don't have to have a go-between as far as a human mediator. I don't have to go to the priest to be able to talk to God or communicate with God, and I don't have to go to a priest to confess my sin to him. I have all that through Christ, and just that reality is very liberating beyond just the other aspects that, hey, look, I don't have to give in to my sin now. I'm free from it.
Yeah. So, all right.
Continuously, I should say, caring for us and works through us because He is alive. And also the unification of the cross. We're here today on Sunday, Easter Sunday, because our Savior, our risen Savior, is alive. And we're here to celebrate that fact. And for the past few years, Easter's always meant that to me.
Yeah. Instead of, okay. Well, let's conclude with the song we began with this morning, page 132, He Lives. And if you can't sing, as I said earlier, shout, because I love that. He lives, He lives. Christ.